a large portion of Americans on both sides of the aisle are now really looking down at the idea of democracy, more supportive of authoritarian measures, and unfortunately, more willing to engage in violence in order to carry out their political goals. So this was a survey that was done by the University of Virginia's Center for Politics, and here are the results. First, the anti-democracy and pro-authoritarian sentiment. 31% of Donald Trump supporters and 24% of President Joe Biden supporters said democracy is no longer viable and an alternative system should be tried. What is the alternative system that you guys want to try? Like, that's what I want to know. You want a monarchy? You want a dictatorship? I mean, it's absurd. And also, just like the oblivious nature of what they're asking for here, because they think, no, 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 the dictatorship that we implement is obviously going to be great to us and terrible to the other side.
Yeah. So, okay. Look, guys, this set of numbers we're about to give you, that was just the first one, tip of the iceberg, is super scary. Society is fraying. Our respect in our institutions and our former government is deteriorating, decaying right in front of our eyes. It feels like the country is a blanket that's pulling apart at the seams. And so the numbers are devastating in and of themselves for how much we don't believe in each other or the system anymore. And I'm gonna get to the root causes a little bit later. But the second reason why these things are devastating, these numbers are, is because Democrats, what are you doing? I mean, this, I get the Republicans saying some of this stuff and I fight against it every day, but let's start with this first one. 24% of Biden supporters saying that democracy is no longer viable and an alternative system should be tried. Okay, if you're a Republican, I get it. Like, we literally had a guy on here backed by Peter Thiel and other clowns who are arguing for a monarchy.
Curtis Yarvin.
Yeah, and so that means dictatorship, right? But if you're a right-wing authoritarian person, that's not that surprising. It sucks, but it's not that, like, freedom is just a punchline for them. But if you're a Democrat, what alternate system? What are we gonna do if it's not democracy? I don't even understand what you're saying. Like, even if you're young and you say, okay, socialism, but wait a minute, that's the economic model. That doesn't have anything to do with the political model. What would we do, socialism without a democracy? That's just becomes a dictatorship instantly.
Yeah,
hard pass. I don't know what in the world they're thinking, but wait till you get to the other numbers.
So 30% of Trump supporters and 25% of Biden supporters said elections should be suspended in times of crisis.
No, it is hard pass,
It is amazing to me. Listen, we obviously have issues in our liberal democracy, but liberal democracy is lit, okay? We should want to save liberal democracy and reform our institutions. The notion that we give up our voice, that we give up what makes democracy amazing, which is allowing people to have a say, make decisions about who they're represented by. The idea that we should just throw that out the window because we have flaws in our current system that need to be reformed is insane to me, absolutely egregious.
Guys, the minute you suspend an election is the minute you put democracy on the chopping block. It's a disastrous idea. Because you're saying in times of crisis, you know what politicians are gonna do? They're gonna invent crisis after crisis after crisis. They're gonna say, well, COVID's a crisis, the Israel-Gaza war's a crisis. Everything's a crisis,
the
right?
The US is always in crisis these
days. Yeah, and so they'll suspend every election until there are no more elections. Hard pass on both of these. Look, we fight against the right wing that says these stuff. If you're on the left, you should never be saying things like this.
Well, get a load of this. Nearly half of Biden supporters, 47%, and 35% of Trump supporters said the government should restrict the expression of views considered discriminatory or offensive.
Oh, come on.
Disagree.
47%? More than the Republicans? No, look, it's a free country. We fight against offensive speech every day on this show. But you fight back with more speech. If you start saying only people who agree with me should be allowed to speak, we're done for. That's not freedom. That's not this country.
And it also makes society dumber.
Yeah, and it by does, the way,
because who are the arbiters of offensive speech?
Exactly. Then you've destroyed democracy because you have to pick someone to be the judge of what speech gets banned.
Right.
Already you're on a disastrous course.
So let's go further with the disastrous course, because now we're going to get into the support for violence against political opponents. When asked whether it is acceptable to employ violence to stop political opponents from attaining their goals, 41% of Biden supporters and 38% of Trump supporters said yes.
This is unreal. So look, the 38% on the Republican side is a number we've seen now in about three polls, right? In that ballpark of now a shocking 40%. And I've been scared to death about it. And then you see the acts of violence. In fact, we have more coming up later in the show about how Jim Jordan's opponents were threatened with violence from right wingers, right? But wow, 41% of Biden supporters, what violence are you gonna do?
So Jim,
and to what end? And when the violence starts, you don't think the right wing has more weapons? That's the dumbest idea I've ever heard in my life.
I think this is a good opportunity to kind of stop and talk a little bit about where I see the problems and why I believe an increasing number of Americans on both sides of the political aisle feel this way. I do think that we're all segregated by our media filters. And the media, because of this competitive environment and the for-profit model, right? What it leads to is the two sides, which represent the two political parties, engaging in increasingly inflammatory, fear-mongering rhetoric about the other side. And so that has kind of informed my decision to bring the temperature down. That's not to say that I agree with everyone on the right. It's not to say that there aren't individuals on the right who preach and advocate for things that I think are incredibly dangerous and yes, violent and anti-democratic. But I think there's a way to talk about those things without inciting fear and absolute violence and hatred for the entirety of the other side. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, 100%. And look, but part of that process is calling out your own side.
Yeah.
So if all you do is they're the bad guys and we're awesome, when they say violence, they're evil and demonic. But when we say violence, it's righteous and beautiful, then you lost a thread. Then you have no principles, you have no consistency. And so then that creates more division and it devolves the situation worse. And it entrenches people into they're evil, you're evil. And what do you do with evil? You don't negotiate with it, you attack, attack, attack. And that's where we are today. So you could, and if you watch the show, and like the reviewers said of my book, the Republicans come in for a shellacking. I'm giving no quarter, that's not the point, guys. Yes, you can fight back on the things that you don't agree on, and you could fight back ferociously on that. But at the end of the day, you have to come back to yes, but they're human and they're Americans and they're part of us. And let's also reach out to their better angels and look at the things that we agree on. So fight on the things we don't agree on, but realize that they're human beings that actually agree with us on a ton of stuff, and pull them in on the things that we agree on and talk about unity and not just division. So, but every other media outlet is driving division, division, division. Those guys are the bad guys. I'll give you one last example is from mainstream media, and then I'm gonna talk about in a second how they're the root cause, in my opinion. Because, so what do they say, and a lot of left-wing shows say this, when Mitch McConnell takes $1 billion in donor money, he's evil, serves corporations, and is a terrible, corrupt person. When Nancy Pelosi takes $1 billion from corporations, same exact thing. They go, no, she's an angel, master legislator, beautiful, great, and looking out for your interests. Then people stop believing in media, in politicians, and they start to lose faith in the entire system. Here, I'll just say it. Look, the root cause is we have a system, but no one clarifies what they mean when they say system. If you're talking about the system of democracy that we have, that's beautiful, and that's the core of what we are as America, and that needs to be protected. But oftentimes, mainstream media conflates that system with the current system of corruption.
With our institutions.
Right, yeah. And currently our institutions are swamped with corruption.
Correct.
And we do not want to protect that corrupt system. But no one ever clarifies, So because the mainstream media is invested in the corruption, they go, no, if you stand against corrupt politicians, then you're against democracy. No, brother, don't do that. Don't do that when you conflate those two things. This is what happens. We start to fray and everybody goes, okay, then I'm done with the system. I guess I don't like democracy. No, democracy is the answer. Corruption is the problem.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. We also love it if you hit the join button below, because that makes you a member, and members allow us to be independent, honest. We can be as progressive as we want, no corporate media influence, and that's all because of you guys. We love doing the show with our members. Hit the join button, become one of the Young Turks.